sent out an email just before class, mentioning a lot of mock hours today, 11 to 12, and then I'll have some more from 1 to 3 or so. The 11 to 12 ones will be normal, you can ask questions about whatever. The 1 to 3 will also be somewhat normal, but I think they'll also do an informal review of some new math stuff, or some topics we didn't cover in the last math review session, but you don't all have to attend. Maybe I'll show you a paper we do talk about, and we'll just talk a little bit about ODE numerically, and talk about fast Fourier transform, and just the concept behind it. It's not going to be a math review of what fast Fourier transform is, because that's really not important for this class. It will conceptually help you understand how the ODE can be used to solve problems. Okay, so I wanted to show a few slides. Can we turn off the very last light? Thank you. All right. So there were three topics that came up with NumPy that were people had the most trouble with. I'd say that one of them would be fancy indexing, especially the Boolean indexing in masks. So we can try an example with that. When dealing with multi-dimensional arrays, it gets a little confusing, the indexing and the order of everything, but I think on these slides, I've got some rules that are going to be generally applicable, and if you want, you can memorize them, or you can just hack around until you get what you want. That's the other thing. I think those are the two biggest. There might be something else that comes up during lecture. So let's talk a little bit about the multi-dimensional arrays. So the rules for arrays of any number of dimensions, let's say we've got this example. A lot of people have trouble with this. If you're manually creating this array, you've got all these brackets here, and it gets a little confusing. So how many dimensions is this? Well, you can kind of figure that out by seeing how many layers of brackets there are, right? So you can tell there's outermost, second outermost, and then there's an innermost sort of bracket. There's nothing within that. So let's see, a one-dimensional array is just going to be, you know, 1, 2, 3. A two-dimensional array is going to have brackets around that. A three-dimensional array is going to have brackets around that. So you can tell just by glancing at it that this is a 3D array because you've got three levels of brackets. Now, the rules for numbers separated by commas are in separate columns. So each of the innermost brackets has some numbers. Typically, in general, they're going to be separated by commas. There's no commas here. So how many columns are we going to have? Raise your hand.
In the uppermost array? Or just total?
Okay, when we have an array, it's going to be of a certain number of dimensions, and each dimension, like x, y, is going to have the same length.
Okay.
So you're not going to have an array where there's like two columns, and it's like 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. This is not a valid array because it has to have another element. So keep in mind that according to the rules, each of these has to have the same number of columns. Okay, that's kind of what I'm getting at. Totally different example here, but point being, it's going to be consistent. Like if this had, you can look at any one of these and say, oh, no, this one in particular, there's no commas in there. Therefore, there can only be how many columns?
Two. Did I say wrong?
Numbers separated by columns are in separate columns. So is there any number separated by commas here? That's what I'm getting at. How many columns do we have?
One.
Just one column here. All right. So there are no numbers that are directly separated by commas. Like, think about the example. X is 1, 2, 3. In this case, there's going to be three columns because the numbers are separated by commas. There's two commas, three columns. In this, there are no commas, one column. This might be a little bit different from how you're used to thinking about it. I'm trying to present it in a way that's going to work for any number of dimensions. Okay? Innermost bracketed groups separated by commas are in different rows. So I could be talking about, these are, this is an innermost bracketed group, this is another innermost bracketed group, these are also, but you can look at either these or those because they have to be consistent. So there's one comma here. How many rows are we going to have though?
Two.
We have two rows. And finally, second innermost bracketed groups separated by commas are on different, what you might call pages. You know, separate, you can think of separate matrices, but remember, 2D arrays are not necessarily the same thing as matrices. Their array operations are totally different in general. So how many pages do we have here? We've got one second innermost bracketed group, or in this case, outermost bracketed group, and another one here. So we've got two separate pages. And what does this look like? Well, when you were punch this into NumPy, you're going to visualize it like this. It's going to show you something like 1, 2, so that's two rows, and it's going to show you 3, 4, and that's to indicate, like, here's one page, here's the second page. What questions do you have about that? We're not talking about indexing it yet, we're just talking about generating, you know, assembling an array, first of all. You think that you can apply these rules, and more generally, and so on. So a third innermost bracketed group is going to be the number of, I don't know, it's hard to think of more numbers of dimensions, but it could always be pages of pages. In a sense. Okay. What questions do you have about this example now? Does this example make sense? It didn't make sense before? Okay. So there were C dot shape. What's the shape here? Somebody raise their hand if you get a ticket. Yeah?
2-2-1.
2-2-1, why is that? What does the first two mean?
Two rows and two pages.
Why is it mixed up like that? Let's stay consistent. So it's always going to be in the reverse order here. So number of pages, number of rows, number of columns is what we've got. So it's going to be 2-2-1, as he said, but that stands for pages, rows, columns. The furthest rightmost is always going to be the number of columns. The second rightmost is going to be the number of rows. The third rightmost is always going to be the number of pages, and so on and so on. This works even if it's just a 1D array. The shape of an array that's just 1, 2, 3, right? That's going to be the number of columns. It's going to be, the shape is going to be 3L there. The shape of this guy is 3. And why does, what is the L, by the way? That just indicates that it's a long, it could be a very large integer. What questions do you have about shape and order? Yeah.
If you only have one row, and if you call for C shift, and there's one comma after.
There's going to be a comma because what does it return? What kind of data type is this in Python? Each one of these is it long. Right, it's an integer. But what is this data type indicated by the parentheses? It's a tuple, and a tuple of length 1 always has a comma afterwards. So that's just the rules of Python. And why does it do that? It's just to indicate that it's a tuple and not just a grouped list, a grouped expression or something. Yeah.
So in math, we usually say the number of rows first and then the number of columns?
That's also true here.
Let's say that we didn't have
third dimension. Number of rows, number of columns.
So it's listed backwards, but it's recited forwards. So it tells you the shape, it'll tell you the right order, but you have to tell it in the opposite order.
Right, give me an example, because I'm not seeing that what you're saying is necessarily
right. Oh, okay. Never mind. I think you just tell it by columns. You say, here's the first column, here's the second column. I think I get it. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay. But, in math, you list the number of rows and the number of columns. That's not changed here. It's just that when you have multiple dimensions, like 3 or more, it gets a little bit confusing because row and column are not the first things that you put. You put first the number of pages, then row, then column. But it always will be row, then column. Yeah. All right. So how about ndim? Somebody asked about that. What's the relationship between ndim and shape? Sorry?
Is it two
Well, M dim is gonna be three. What's the relationship between that and shape? Actually, can you write something in Python that's always gonna be true? What can you do to shape to get the M dim? Yeah, take the len of shape is gonna be the number of dimensions. Exactly. Right? The length of this is gonna be the number of dimensions. So let's talk about indexing now. So when we're trying to grab an element out, you'll see those rules are pretty similar. So the last index is going to select the column, the second to last index is going to select the row, the third to last index selects the page, etc. So we've got this guy here, and these are my random numbers, and let's say that I want to extract the middle element. What's the way of indexing that? Let's say this is called C. What's this one here? So somebody raise their hand, I'll give you a ticket for it. Yeah?
C bracket 1,
okay, because this is 0, this is 1, this is 0. Good, I'll give you a ticket, even though that is pretty easy. All right, how about this guy here? 2, 3, that's what it looks like. And think for a second about, how do I get that element out? Somebody raise their hand. Yeah?
0, 2.
0 meaning?
The very first row.
0 meaning the zeroth row or the first row, yeah. And 2 meaning the second column, third in order. Sure, that's right. So row, column. That guy there? Think about it for yourself. It's going to be 1, 0 because we're in the first row of 0th column. So the last index is the column. And the second to last index is the row. Normally you think about it the other way around, but when you get to multiple dimensions, you kind of need to think from last to first, if you want to be careful about it. All right, finally this guy here, then according to these rules, how would I select this element there? Everybody think for a second. Form your answer in your mind, I'm gonna let one person answer. Okay, so what does 1 mean here? It's page because it's the third to last index, selecting page, the third to last index. So she says 1. Okay, so page 1, this is page 0. And then 1?
0.
So the second to last index selects the row. She says it's 0, so this is row 0, this is row 1. Okay, so we've got 1, 0. And then the last one is a 2. The third to last index, or excuse me, the very last index selects the column, and this is in column number 2. So 0, 1, 2. And you're absolutely right. 1, 0, 2. Okay, so these rules, while they might be a little bit different from how you're used to thinking about it, because you're used to just thinking about row, column, and row first, then column. Well, when you add other dimensions, they go before those dimensions. You need to maybe modify the understanding when you think about 4 or 5-dimensional array. I think I've worked with up to 4-dimensional arrays in NumPy. Beyond that, probably something's wrong. Don't force yourself to use multi-dimensional arrays. Also, I'm not sure if it's true in MATLAB, but I'm not sure if it's still true in NumPy, but I've tried dealing with higher dimensional arrays to what's called vectorize operations. So if you know about vectorizing operations, that's what NumPy is good at. Vectorize means to do the calculation on all the elements simultaneously. If X is an array and I take the sine of X, I call that a vectorized computation because I'm doing the sine on all the elements simultaneously, right? Point being, I didn't write a for loop to do it. That's called vectorization. I found sometimes creating multiple dimensional arrays instead of writing a for loop so that you can do a vectorized calculation can still turn out to be slower, which is kind of counterintuitive. The idea of NumPy and MATLAB is that you're supposed to be able to do these computations on large groups of numbers at once without writing for loops. That's what vectorization is for, and that's supposed to be faster. That's not always the case. It's possible to come up with situations in which that doesn't quite work. But there are many simple cases, like one-dimensional arrays, definitely.
Don't write a for loop over a one-dimensional array. Don't even write a for loop over a two-dimensional array if you want it to be vectorized computation. There's no time to do it on everything at once. People have questions about plotting then some, how do you do the computation on everything at once? So people ask questions about how you plot that cosine curve. And the way that you do that is, let's see, I guess I can't open it up right now. But let's say that we've imported matplotlib.pyplot as PLT, right? We saw pyplot. And we've also opened up NumPy, and that's always imported as NP, by the way. It's just very standard, NumPy, NP. So you might use np.linspace to generate an array of x coordinates. So 0 to np.pi, maybe, times 2. So this is pi defined within NumPy. And let's get 100 different points between that. So the way to visualize that, I need a blank screen here. Okay, much better. Okay, so let's say that x is that. So the way to visualize that is I've created from 0 to 2 pi, I've created 100 different points. So my x is an array of 100 equally spaced points between 0 and 2 pi. And then I'd say y is, do I just say cosine or np.cosine? So I think that's where people got confused. They're trying to, like, from math, import star and then try cosine. But that's not going to work. The cosine function from the math module is defined for floats or integers, maybe. It's not defined for NumPy arrays. It's not a built-in function, so NumPy couldn't overload that with magic methods. So you have to use NumPy sine function or cosine function, which is good to work on arrays, say x. And then I can use from matplotlib.pyplot plt.plot x and then y. That was a bad example. What questions do you have about that and why you have to use NumPy's cosine function? That's the one that's defined for arrays. And note, we're doing this cosine function on all these elements in one call. We didn't have to write at the same time. We didn't have to write a for loop.
I think you have to import for pyplot is just import pyplot.
Import matplotlib dot pyplot. And we always do that as PLT. That's just kind of standard. Just like NumPy being imported as NumPy. All right, let's do an example with masking and fancy indexing. Okay? So let's do just a simple one-dimensional array here. So I'm going to write the Python code kind of loosely here. 0, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 there. And I want you to select with your fancy indexing this one and this one simultaneously. I want you to write some sort of indexing. What goes in here to give me just these two elements back? Yeah? Yeah? Yeah, 0 and then 5 is going to work, right? Oh, negative 1, that's also going to work, probably. That'll work as well. And what's that doing? That's saying I've got a list here. And I want to get, so that means I'm going to name the 0th element and the 5th element are the ones that I want. Right? So that's going to do it. What's another way of doing it? What else could go in here?
The last one you could say n, right? Is it the wrong finish?
What's that?
Could, to such that last element of an array, could you say n?
No, minus 1 is what she was saying.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, she said minus 1. Yeah? What did I write?
So 0 and yeah. The
2 dot. Colon?
Yeah.
Minus 1?
Mm-hmm.
And then 2?
to get to?
So from zero to the last in increments of two, I'm not sure if that's gonna work.
No,
that's just not how, that's not how colon works. The colon means the same thing as it did for lists. So if you are having questions about the basic slicing, and that's actually not what I'm asking about here, slicing is not the strategy. You could do a slicing strategy. You can say go, let's say I could go from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 in increments of 4. So I could go, yeah, this would be a valid slice. So I could get 0 and 5 that way. That would work. But I'm looking for something totally different from slicing. And slicing, if you're having trouble with that, that's just, that's review from lists. Yeah?
Could you just do x bracket and x bracket 0 comma x bracket 4?
Well, I could do that, yeah. Okay, so yeah, I could do that and then x bracket 4, but then I want, let's say I want these to be in an array of some sort, right? Well, I could put them in array, yeah, I can do that, but there's...
X
one to five
is equal
to 0.
X 1
to 5 is equal to... Modulo. Modulo? Okay. Oh, yeah, there we go. Okay, so you're starting to get at masking. All right, X modulo 5, you say?
Mm-hmm.
Is it 5? Oh, yeah, I guess... Yeah, 5. Modulo 5 is 0. Okay, she's got a clever way here. What does this end up doing? Let's think about that. You're getting a ticket for that. I was going to just put out the Boolean array of trues and falses, but that's absolutely correct. Okay, so what does this do? This does an element by element, element-wise operation on x that takes the modulo with 5. So let's take the modulo with 5. The modulo of this with 5 is 0. Modulo of this is 1. Modulo of this is 2, 3, 4. Modulo of this is 5. Excuse me, 0. All right. So now we've said, all right, so that's the first intermediate step. So this is x modulo 5. All right. Now we do x modulo 5. Is that equal to 0? This is true. So I'm just going to check to mean true and x to mean false. False, 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 true. All right, then we use that as an index. It turns out this is just a fancy way of indexing. It says, okay, we want this element. Check. 0. We don't want that element. We don't want that element. We don't want that element, nor do we want that one. We want this one here. That's going to give us 5 back. That's another way of doing the operation. So that's Boolean indexing for you. And it takes a little practice to start thinking that way, but it turns out to be very, very useful in lots of different problems. Thank you. And you can do that not just for one-dimensional arrays. You can do that for two-dimensional arrays. You could also mix and match, right? I think there was an example. There was an example where it had, and it wanted you to select this element and this element, or something like that, right? So I could use Boolean indexing to select the row, and then I could use regular simple indexing to do the column. And so the way that you can do it here is you can say this is x, then I can say x, and I can create a Boolean array with something like true, false, true, and then I would select the column number 1. This is not real Python code, this is just pseudocode getting you used to the concept of Boolean indexing. I'm saying true, that means I want to select the 0th column because it's in the 0th place. This one here is in the first place, false. I don't want to select that column. True, I do want to select this next column here. So just the order in which these are, or the order, order of the rows that I want to select. I say column and it's in these. And here, okay? I put the comma, that means I'm moving on, I'm no longer selecting rows, I'm selecting columns, I want to select column number one. You could do slices up here too. So you can mix and match between the fancy indexing and the slices. Now,
Can you use like other commands on a Boolean mask? Like, can you make create one with like the diagonal thing, or could you like tile them?
Yeah, you can create a Boolean mask that's the same shape as, I believe you could use the Boolean mask that's the same shape as the entire array. So you set diag, right? So if the diag method creates a diagonal, like 2D, for instance, and with like the numbers along the diagonal. And so I think that you can index with a two-dimensional mask, and that would get you out. That's not the most efficient way of doing it, I don't think, but that is a way that you can do it, yeah. But you actually wouldn't want diag, you'd want I, numpy dot I, because that's going to be zeros or ones, truths or falses. Yeah? That's a little basics. I suggest that you practice with the Boolean indexing. So I'm not going to give you too many more examples, but if you do have a question about a particular example and how it works, if you really can't figure out with some testing, go ahead and bring it to me, and I can maybe help you out with that. Yeah? Sorry, what creates copies and not views?
Fancy
indexing. Okay, so a view is just looking at the data in a different way, as the name view suggests. So maybe it helps to understand a little bit about what NumPy is doing for you. These NumPy arrays are stored as contiguous arrays, like C++ arrays, basically. They're in memory consecutively. And so you can, like, let's say that all these numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, okay? These numbers are all in memory consecutively. There's a lot of different ways that I can look at this. I can look at this as a 1x8 array. I can look at this as an 8x1 array. I can look at it as a 2x4, as a 4x2. Depending on how I decide I'm going to look at these numbers, what the dimensions of my NumPy array is going to be, these same consecutive numbers can be treated differently. Does that sort of make sense? In memory on the computer, you've just got consecutive numbers, and there's a separate parameter, a separate thing that the NumPy array object remembers, which is its shape. Does that make sense? This is how the memory on my computer is laid out consecutively, like that. Right? And so I could, when I store the data on the computer, this could be the data that is stored for a 2x4 array, right? If I say that my shape of my NumPy array is 2x4, then it's going to be looking at, it's going to basically be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. If I say that I want the shape of my array to be 1x8, then I'm going to think of it as 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8. I just skipped 4. That was dumb. Okay. Depending on what I say that my shape is, I can, these arrays, the data of them is, for both arrays, it's going to be stored in the same way in memory on the computer. It's just going to be consecutive numbers. There's just this other thing, the shape, that the NumPy array remembers, so that it knows how to turn an index into a particular value. Okay, so that is one concept that you need to understand in order to understand views. Okay, so you said something about transpose. Was that just a view? No, fancy indexing. Okay. So with slicing, let's say that this is a 1x8 array, okay? Or like, just say it's an 8 combo. So just 8 columns. So 1D array, 8 columns. If we do slicing on this, and we say x from 2 to 5, that's trying to get out 2 through 3, 4, 5, not inclusive, these elements, right? I've got the option of creating a copy of this, so taking what's in this memory, allocating new memory, and entering 3, 4, 5 in here. That's a copy of it, right? Or I could basically just say that this is an object, so let's say this is an object in memory, right? I'm going to create another object in memory instead that just kind of looks at whatever is in this segment. So yeah, I have two options. I can either copy this data into this new object in memory, or I can make this object in memory refer to this stuff. The first option, the copy, it's obviously called a copy. This option is called a view. We're just looking at whatever data is over here. And it turns out that slicing just creates a view. It creates this, returns a slice object, sliced array object. It's all treated as a, that's not a slice object. It's a NumPy array object of some sort. Point being that they share memory though. This NumPy array and this NumPy array, this one refers to this one to get its data. So if I change this one, so this is y, and I say y element 0 gets 10. Well, y element 0 is this one here. It's changing it to 10. And so x is changed as well. This original x has also changed. That's the idea of a view, is that it's not copying the data, it is just referring to the original data, and it is choosing to look at it slightly differently. I've changed the meaning of indices because I'm only looking at this part. You can also create a view that reshapes things. And so it treats the same stuff in memory, not as an 8 comma nothing array, it's a 2 by 4 array. But it's still using this data. You modify one, you change the other. And that's the data's only stored in one place. All right, so Boolean indexing, on the other hand, I can also get out these elements, but if I use Boolean indexing or fancy indexing to get there, if I say x, give me 2, 3, 4, that's fancy indexing, right? Because there's not as much of a pattern with fancy indexing, you're allowed to access things in a more scattered way. It's not always possible to create a view efficiently the way that NumPy stores data, and so it's always going to copy the data. So instead of referring to this first array, it's going to take those elements out, this little 3, and it's going to make a new thing here. And so when I change y element 0 gets 10, I'm only changing this guy. This is not changed with a copy. Does that answer your question?
So it's like decopying this.
I think that there's only one, in this case, I know the difference between shallow and deep copy. I think that both of these are just a regular old copy. This copy is not necessarily a deep or shallow copy, it's just a copy. Sure, it's a deep copy, because it copies everything down to the lowest level, but there's only one level, so it's the same with the shallow copy. Okay. What other questions do you have? Does that make sense? Then, what questions do you have about fancy indexing, giving you a copy, slicing, giving you a view? You ready for the quiz? What other questions do you have about NumPy before you get to the quiz then? Let's go ahead and do the quiz. The password is NumPyNinja. And after the quiz, you're welcome to work on the assignment or the preparation, whatever, and ask me for help. Well, then once you work on, well, that you have stuff downloaded. That sucks. Right, you need to try reloading it. Okay, well, I'm not sure what to say. Should I do other examples? Anybody have any other questions? Got nothing else to do. I can't even bring up the questions that people ask online. Oh, maybe I can do that on my phone.
So like in Python, if you were to use like C++ terminology, like everything is like a reference pretty much.
Yeah.
Okay, is that always true? Can you declare something that's not that way?
In Python, variables that you give names to, x, y, those
yeah.
are always references.
Okay, cool.
When you have an object, so that like x and y could be references to objects, but those objects could be copies of one another, or they could be referenced to, one of them could be a reference to the other one.
Yeah.
And that becomes the funny thing.
So when you want to make a copy, you have to use some other terminology, like slice it with just a colon.
Yeah, that's an example. That's a very easy way of making a copy of NumPy is by using that colon operator.
Okay.
I think that's only gonna, so that's gonna work really well with a one-dimensional array. You might want colon, comma, colon for a two-dimensional array.
Okay.
I'm not sure if that's required though. So sometimes you get MATLAB and Python that confused, and so I test it myself because MATLAB and Python are similar in that regard, but they're slightly different. Especially if anybody does know MATLAB, by the way of indexing multidimensional arrays is different. In MATLAB, it is always row, comma, column, comma, maybe even the page. It could be a different order in MATLAB.
Semicolon started you? Column?
Yeah, I'm talking about indexing.
Oh, okay.
It's in the brackets. Is the internet back? Broadcasting. We didn't talk about that. Let's talk about that for a second before you're waiting for the quiz, okay? The basic idea is they wanted to make it flexible so that you can add arrays or do basic operations on arrays of different shapes. You all know that if you have 1, 2, 3, and you multiply that by 4, 5, or 6. Let's just do addition, okay? Let's do the addition. Well, for regular Python lists, right, this is going to concatenate them. But let's think about for a NumPy array. It does element-wise operations. Three-long list and a three-long list, that makes sense. If you do that element-wise, it's going to be 5, 7, and 9. That's going to be the result. That's element-wise addition. But what if our arrays are shaped differently? Well, I'll tell you one case that's not defined. You can't add this to that, right? This is not going to work. That doesn't make any sense. 1, 2, 3. And then these, you can't do element-wise addition. But what if you change one of the dimensions? If this is instead shaped 1, 2, 3, then this could make sense. There is a way of making this make sense. You could say first row of this guy gets added to the first column of this. So here, actually, let me draw these like this. We want to do addition between these. It's helpful to
corresponding elements. 5, 1 plus 5 is 6, 1 plus 6 is 7, 1 plus 7 is 8. Second row, 2 plus 4 is 6, 7, 8, 9, 7, 8, 9, 10. So if you add these two arrays of different shapes and different numbers and dimensions like this, then you can start to envision a way that addition can make sense. And this is called broadcasting. This is one particular example of broadcasting. But the point is, sometimes there are ways of making sense of basic operations involving arrays of different shapes, including different numbers of elements. They just have to be arranged in different dimensions. Another way of thinking about it is, before we did the addition, we copied these elements here. This now became an array of 1s in the first row, 2s in the second row, 3s in the third row, such that there are 4 total columns. And this one, we copied the rows so that we have a column that's all 4s, a column that's all 5, a column that's all 6, a column that's all 7s, such that now that these two-dimensional arrays match each other. Do the addition between the two, and you'll get this guy. So those are some ways about thinking about what broadcasting is doing. I don't know the general rules myself. It's actually often just kind of intuitive with practice, so I haven't memorized them. And I suggest that you do the same by practicing a little bit. Typically, you're only going to need to worry about broadcasting with, you know, arrays that live within two dimensions or so. It's usually not much more complicated than that. There's not too many different options you can get. But it is important to understand that addition or multiplication even with broadcasting is different from matrix operations. Is the internet back? All right, go ahead and take the quiz now, and I think that that last comment should help you on that. Sine and cosine as solutions to a particular differential equation as well, right? And we just happen to have given them names that are familiar to everybody because they're useful in all sorts of contexts. But this one is, you know, the general solution to this type of differential equation. We just don't encounter it very often. Thank you. Homework is due, that was assigned today? Yeah, homework assigned today, assignment 5-6W is due on 7W. Friday, there's no class, so we treat it as though it didn't exist.